You're taking the grace from your page.
We got done.
Are you done?
Yeah, we ain't got put away yet, but we're done.
How many?
We got 2,500 this year.
Oh, my God.
We were busy for a while. The dry weather helped us a lot.
Yeah. You know, we did, we had a spell just about a lot of.
Yeah, it was.
People been bailing like crazy.
Yeah, now you gotta be so careful so you don't start a fire.
Yeah.
It's so dry.
Right.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We welcome you to our worship on this, the fourth Sunday after Pentecost. This is also the Sunday that falls within the July 4th weekend. And you'll pick up a little flavor of that with the opening and the closing hymn and the prayers. If you didn't notice, I put the July newsletter in the mailboxes in the narthex there. I'll try to remember to mention it to you as you go out as well, just in case. Thought I would do that this time and see how that works. Today is our service in Divine Service Setting 1, page 151, and we open with number 966, Before You, Lord, We Bow.
You.
name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us then confess our sins to God our Father.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
You may be seated. The intro is taken from Psalm 19. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. Day to day pours out speech, and night to night reveals knowledge. Their measuring line goes out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them he has set a tent for the sun, which comes out like a bridegroom leaving his chamber, and like a strong man runs its course with joy. Its rising is from the end of the heavens, and its circuit to the end of them, and there is nothing hidden from its heat. Glory be to the Father,
and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. We continue with the Kyrie, Lord have mercy, on page 152. In peace let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
For our hymn of praise, we sing number 821.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let's pray. Almighty God, you have built your church on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. Continue to send your messengers to preserve your people in true peace, that by the preaching of your word, your church may be kept free from all harm and danger. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may follow the scripture readings from the back of your bulletin. The concluding chapters of Isaiah express a joyful hope in the future, a time when God shall return and establish a new heaven and a new earth. There will be a new Jerusalem from whom all the faithful people of God shall be nourished. In this section, the new Jerusalem is compared to a mother who nourishes and comforts her children. In the middle of our reading, the image shifts dramatically, and now God himself is described as a mother who nurses, cares for, and comforts her children. The final verse tells of the joy of the people when they know they are under the power of the Lord. The Old Testament reading for the fourth Sunday after Pentecost is from Isaiah chapter 66. Rejoice with Jerusalem and be glad for her, all you who love her. Rejoice with her in joy, all you who mourn over her, that you may nurse and be satisfied from her consoling breast, that you may drink deeply with delight from her glorious abundance. For thus says the Lord, behold, I will extend peace to her like a river, and the glory of the nations like an overflowing stream. And you shall nurse, you shall be carried upon her hip and bounced upon her knees. As one whom his mother comforts, so I will comfort you. You shall be comforted in Jerusalem. You shall see, and your heart shall rejoice. Your bones shall flourish like the grass, and the hand of the Lord shall be known to his servants, and he shall show his indignation against his enemies. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second lesson covers two distinct themes in chapter 6. The first part includes practical suggestions on how the Christian, freed by the love of Christ, should show that love for others. He warns, however, that whatever we do in love is all subject to glorying only in the cross of Jesus and not glorying in ourselves for our acts of love. The second section restates an essential point of the letter, that keeping the Old Testament laws of circumcision does not save us, only the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. The epistle is from Galatians chapter 6. Brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks he is something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. But let each one test his own work, and then his reason to boast will be in himself alone and not in his neighbor. For each will have to bear his own load. One who is taught the word must share all good things with the one who teaches. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever one sows, that will he also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. But the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. And let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap, if we do not give up. So then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially to those who are of the household of faith. But far be it from me to boast, except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. For neither circumcision counts for anything, nor uncircumcision, but a new creation. And as for all who walk by this rule, peace and mercy be upon them and upon the Israel of God. From now on, let no one cause me trouble, for I bear on my body the marks of Jesus. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit, brothers. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today's reading from Luke's Gospel tells the story of Christ appointing 72 men in teams of two to go into all the villages and towns, proclaiming the gospel and announcing the coming of the kingdom of God.
They're not to worry about their own physical needs, but in faith, carry out their mission. They are given power to heal, which will be a sign to people that God's power is upon them. The concluding verses show that their mission was successful. The words of Jesus on the lips of the disciples are powerful and lead people through Jesus to God. Let us rise for the reading of the Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 10th chapter. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them on ahead of him, two by two, into every town and place where he himself was about to go. And he said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go your way. Behold, I am sending you out as lambs in the midst of wolves. Carry no money bag, no knapsack, no sandals, and greet no one on the road. Whatever house you enter, first say, 'Peace be to this house.' And if a son of peace is there, your peace will rest upon him. But if not, it will return to you. And remain in the same house, eating and drinking what they provide, for the laborer deserves his wages. Do not go from house to house. Whenever you enter a town and they receive you, eat what is set before you. Heal the sick in it, and say to them, 'The kingdom of God has come near to you.' But whenever you enter a town and they do not receive you, go into its streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town shall cling, that clings to our feet, we wipe off against you.' Nevertheless, know this, that the kingdom of God has come near. I tell you, it will be more bearable on that day of Sodom than for that town. Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Bethsaida! For if the mighty works done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago, sitting in sackcloth and ashes. But it will be more bearable in the judgment for Tyre and Sidon than for you. And you, Capernaum, will you be exalted to heaven? You shall be brought down to Hades. The one who hears you hears me. And the one who rejects you rejects me. And the one who rejects me rejects him who sent me." The 72 returned with joy, saying, "Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name." And he said to them, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Behold, I have given you authority to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the powers of the enemy, and nothing shall hurt you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice in this, that the spirits are subject to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise
we join in confessing our Christian faith in the words of the Nicene Creed on page 158. "I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen."
May be seated. We continue with hymn number 704.
Thank you.
from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The text that I've chosen for this Sunday, Galatians chapter 6, verses 7 and 8 from our epistle reading. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever one sows, that will he also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh, the NIV puts it this way, the one who sows to please his sinful nature will from the flesh reap corruption or destruction. But the one who sows to please the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. This is the text. Dear Christian friends, there are certain axioms or statements which people universally accept as true. For example, we know it to be true that what goes up must come down. That's the law of gravity at work. It happens every time. In today's text, we hear the Apostle Paul talk about another law, the law of sowing and reaping. Simply put, this law states you reap what you sow. Experience has shown that this law is just as reliable as the law of gravity. Every farmer, and even us non-farmers, knows that when you sow wheat in a field, it comes up wheat, not corn. And every gardener knows that when you plant cucumbers, you get cucumbers, not tomatoes. When the Apostle Paul writes in the text, whatever one sows, that will he also reap, he wasn't so much teaching us a lesson in agriculture as he was teaching us a lesson about human nature, a lesson about life. The point he was making applies not only to farmers and gardeners, but to people of every station in life. The truth of this rule has been proven again and again in the lives of people in every culture and time. A person reaps what he sows. If that's the case, then the critical question for us to ask is, how are we sowing? As we ask ourselves this question, let's take a careful look at the two possible ways of sowing mentioned by Paul in the text, and the harvest that comes from each. In the first place, Paul says, the one who sows to his own flesh, or to please his sinful nature, will from the flesh reap corruption or destruction. What the Bible speaks of as the flesh is our inborn corrupt nature, the unregenerate self. The Bible pictures us as possessing from birth a nature that is in a state of rebellion against God and dedicated to the service of sin. We refer to it sometimes as the old Adam. The word Adam is chosen to set up the contrast with the second Adam. One of them got us into sin. The other one, the second Adam, Jesus, gets us out. In last Sunday's epistle lesson, we heard that the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit. To put it another way, if the Spirit says yes, the sinful nature says no. Paul goes on to give us a catalog of some of the sins which result when we sow to please the sinful nature, such things as sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these, etc., etc. In the political realm, we need to heed the warning expressed in Proverbs 22, verse 8, whoever sows injustice will reap calamity. Our country has come a long way in righting the wrongs of past injustice, such as slavery and racial discrimination, but we're still paying the price in enmity, strife, dissensions, and divisions. And we will continue to do so until we see one another as individuals created by God and redeemed by Christ, not as classes locked in eternal conflict. As we think of reaping what we sow, we can't help but think of the frightful harvest that our society is now reaping from the seeds of its own moral breakdown. Paul begins his list with sexual immorality, impurity, and sensuality. Another axiom, nothing new under the sun. The seeds of the new morality, or the old morality that's never left us, are reflected in the changing attitude towards sex outside of marriage. Popular TV situation comedies and countless movies portray these violations of God's standard as the norm, not as the exception. Biblical standards of sexuality are ignored or held up for ridicule. Seldom, if ever, is the true harvest, the consequences of such activity, portrayed. There is the harvest of unwanted pregnancy, often resulting in abortion, higher divorce rates, and the list goes on. Who's to blame? The schools? The churches? The media? All must share part of the blame. But what we need most desperately are homes where parents, assisted by the church, clearly teach their children about God's good gift of sex, as well as his gift of marriage. That would be marriage by God's design. Marriage as the sacred lifelong union of one man and one woman. We need parents who model faithfulness and love in their own married lives. We need parents who recognize their own past failings and humbly give witness to the power of repentance and forgiveness, restoration, and renewal. In the whole area of sexuality, one of the great challenges to the church today is how to address the issue of homosexuality, and with it, same-sex marriage. Many churches solve the problem by throwing out what Scripture has to say on the subject, that homosexual acts, homosexual behavior is sinful. Individual Christians solve the problem by remaining silent or bowing to the culture. That's no solution for those who hold to the authority of Scripture, who wish to be true to God's Word. Nor is it the loving thing to do if we want to lead sinners to their Savior. As one writer puts it, if we affirm the evil that God condemns, we thereby push away the forgiveness God provides for such sins. Let's be clear. God's word of law applies to sins committed by heterosexuals as well as homosexuals. Both need to hear and heed what the Creator says about human sexuality. Both are sinners in need of a Savior, and both can find forgiveness and help from the Savior who loves them and went to the cross for them. From the ministry of Jesus, we see that he did not hesitate to associate with sinners of every stripe, while not condoning their sin. What he offered in every case was his love and forgiveness. Again and again, it was that love, we might call it the action or power of the gospel, that brought change in their lives. The Apostle Paul spoke of the power of the gospel to produce change. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, we read, "Do not be deceived, neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who practice homosexuality, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers, will inherit the kingdom of God." Wait for it. "And such were some of you." Were, but no more. Paul continues, "But you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God." Yes, there is gospel power in the washing of water with the word. There's power in the blood shed on the cross. Sanctifying power available to every sinner. And not just for some sins, but for all sins. God sends help to struggling sinners through his people, through you and me, as we care for one another within the body of Christ, even as our Lord cares for us. We bear one another's burdens, as Paul says in today's epistle lesson. Brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual, church leaders to be sure, but individual Christians as well, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. It's the spirit of gentleness that is too often missing in our interactions with others. We regard some sins as worse than others, and that's usually the sins of others, not our own. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted, is needed advice. Keep watch on your tongue, lest the gospel's voice be silenced by vitriol and hate. Every one of us experiences temptation, the pull of sin, and we've all succumbed, not just once, but again and again. I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but that will be true till the day we die. No sin is unforgivable. Where sin abounds, grace abounds even more, as Paul says in Romans 5:20. That's not a call to sin or to continue sinning, but a call to bring every sin to the foot of the cross, where no sin is too great. God cannot be mocked, Paul solemnly warns. Those who defy his will and reject his standards would always be the losers, if not immediately, then eventually. No one is going to make a fool out of God. He always has the last word. Paul also mentions such acts of the sinful nature as hatred and jealousy and selfish ambition. Wherever selfishness is sown, it reaps a harvest of bitterness and sorrow. Friendships are destroyed and enemies are created. We become jealous of others. We trample on others in our pursuit of property, power, and prestige. We may win the whole world only to destroy or lose ourselves. In today's culture, we hear the demand for personal rights without regard for the rights of others, including the unborn. It scares me to think what we have sowed in our nation with the death of 63 million preborn children. Can you picture the scene a few years down the road from now as the adults of this present generation who have rationalized the taking of human life based on economic and social factors plead with their children, those who escaped abortion, to spare their lives now that they are no longer productive, no longer wanted, no longer regarded, or now regarded as liabilities. After all, every parent, a wanted parent. Touche. Having sown the wind, we will be reaping the whirlwind, as Hosea puts it. Sowing to please the sinful nature, again, the flesh does bring its reward, though it's an unwanted reward, to be sure. St. Paul tells us that the one who sows to please his sinful nature, from that nature will reap corruption will reap destruction. This is an absolute rule which allows for no exceptions. By corruption, by destruction, Paul means more than just loss of happiness, loss of rewards, even loss of life. He takes us into eternity and pictures man's eternal ruin, his everlasting damnation, his eternal separation from God and heaven. These words of Paul should surely cause us to examine our lives, to ask ourselves whether we are sowing to the flesh, sowing to please our sinful nature, whether we are opposing the desires of the Holy Spirit for our lives. Perhaps we've managed to stay clear from the inroads of the new morality, but that doesn't mean that we don't have to fight every day with our sinful nature. The devil loves to see us sow the seeds of indifference to God's word, callousness to the needs of others, pride in our own goodness. The resulting harvest is one of destruction. Paul's words are nothing less than an urgent call for us to repent and turn from our sinful ways. If in the past we have been sowing to please our sinful nature, we need to ask God today for forgiveness. It's not too late. But only through Christ and through the forgiveness which he offers can we stop the inevitable harvest of destruction. Without sincere sorrow of heart and faith in Jesus Christ, sowing to the Spirit is an absolute impossibility. But where the Holy Spirit's gift of faith has brought us into union with Christ, joined us to Christ, where he has moved us to confess our sins and trust in Christ, we begin to desire the things which the Spirit desires. With the power and the desire that he works in us, we are able to live a life which is pleasing to God. We're able to produce the fruit of the Spirit, which were mentioned in last Sunday's epistle lesson as love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. The ultimate result where the Spirit is at work in the hearts and lives of believers is described by St. Paul. The one who sows to please the Spirit from the Spirit will reap eternal life. Not merely life with God here and now, as great and wonderful as that is, but also life with God forever in heaven. From first to last, it's the Spirit's doing, the Spirit who works through the gospel in word and sacrament. At no time is there reason for us to boast in ourselves, in our good work. Our prayer is that of St. Paul. May I never boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's on that cross, after all, that Jesus suffered and died for you and me to redeem us from sin, death, and hell. By his perfect life and his innocent death, Jesus sowed the seed that produced the harvest of our redemption. We give him all the credit. We thank him for his amazing grace. Grace that could love and forgive sinners like us who have made mistakes in our past. And then put us on a right course and use us for his purposes. Jesus once said, every healthy, every good tree bears good fruit. The Holy Spirit makes us good by his sanctifying power. He makes us holy and righteous in God's sight by taking what belongs to Jesus and crediting it to us. He sows the seed of the gospel in our hearts and produces in us the good fruit of a Christian life and the final harvest of eternal life. How foolish it is to sow to the flesh, to sow to please our sinful nature. It seems so wise at first. It seems as though the bill will never come due, but we reap what we sow. And in this case, it's nothing less than destruction. Our fervent prayer today is that God's with God's help, we will daily sow to please the Spirit. That God's Spirit will take control of our thinking and doing, causing us to desire those things which He desires, to do the things which are pleasing to Him. And then, by God's grace, we will reap a bountiful, rich harvest, one that ends in heaven's eternal joy and peace. Amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. In our prayers, we remember Jacob and Karen Bjornstad. Both of them are recovering from COVID. Roger Hansen with certain health concerns. Carrie Dunnigan, husband is married, dialysis treatment which continues. Bernie Kochenberg, brother-in-law Richard Sturgeon with dementia. Ken Welch, Gilbert Watson's brother-in-law with also health concerns. Sheila Rican's sister, Debbie Smith, with serious health issues, as she mentioned here not too long ago. And we've been asked to add Lauren McGregor. He's the brother of Sharon and Gloria. He has cancerous brain tumor and will have surgery this coming Thursday. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Almighty Father, your kingdom has come near to us through the preaching of the word of Jesus. He alone gives us life and makes us your household, your family, where you dwell by your Holy Spirit. Enable us to receive your word with trusting hearts, knowing that the message we hear today is the living and active voice of Jesus. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
When you sent out workers into your harvest field, O Lord, you equipped them to proclaim the message of peace and salvation to all who would listen. Even when they faced rejection, you remained faithful to them and strengthened them through your ongoing presence in their lives. We praise you for doing the same in our lives today, gracious Lord. Even as your church goes through challenging times, remind us that your mission continues and your presence remains with us always. Lord, in your mercy, merciful King, equip all pastors, teachers, missionaries, and servants of your church to know your love and declare it boldly to those you have called them to serve. Bless the partnership of the gospel that is ours in the household of faith, that we may work together as brothers and sisters in Christ in the ventures you have prepared for us. Bless our ministry and mission here, that we may worship you in spirit and in truth, doing all that we can to proclaim your word in our community. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Healing, Lord, remember also those who are sick, homebound, hospitalized, under treatment, to receive surgery, and for other reasons. They are unable to join us now in person. Send your Spirit to fill their hearts and homes with your perfect peace, especially with Jacob and Karen, Roger, Harry, Sky, Bernie, Ken, Debbie, Lauren, those that we name in our hearts as well. That they may be restored by your mighty healing hand and ever praise you for your work in their lives. We thank you, O Lord, that you hear and heal. Answer and bless all those who call out to you for mercy. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Sovereign God, you are exalted above all nations, rulers, and authorities on earth. Today we pray for our nation as we celebrate the anniversary of our independence. Continue to bless our country and keep us mindful of your blessings. Raise up godly men and women who will serve among us and work for the common good. Place your hand upon all public servants and members of the armed forces, that they may know your presence and provision in their lives. Almighty God, bless our native land. Govern us by your grace that we may experience your lasting peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In your hands, O Lord, we commend ourselves and all those for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. We continue with the service of the sacrament, beginning on page 160. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name evermore, praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers. Deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
O Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Lamb of God,
you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace.
Our hymn here before communion is Just As I Am, number 570.
Blood for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in true faith unto life everlasting. Go in peace. Amen. And blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. Welcome to the Lord's table. This is the true body of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, given into death for your sins. The body of Christ for you. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in body and soul. Life everlasting. Go in peace. Amen. Welcome to the Lord's table. Take. Eat. This is the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given into death for your sins. The body of Christ given for you.
Take. And drink. This is the true blood, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for forgiveness of our sins.
May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting. Go in peace. Body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and given into death for your sins. That's his job.
Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, shed for forgiveness of our sins.
May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting. Depart in peace. Join in the song of Simeon, the Nunc Dimittis, page 165. Lord, now you let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled.
My own eyes have seen the salvation that you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal to the nations and the glory of your people Israel. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, you have given us a foretaste of the feast to come in the Holy Supper of your Son's body and blood. Keep us firm in the true faith throughout our days of pilgrimage, that on the day of his coming we may, together with all your saints, celebrate the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom which has no end. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
We close with, God bless our native land and lands. If you would like to see our response, our